You started with telecom. I just want to get back there because we've had one big bump up in after looking at Bharti's earnings and the price increases which came through. But the recent earnings from Idea have been a bit disappointing. Do you have to, can you take a sector call there of the top two companies, or do you have to be stock specific?
So I typically don't take sector calls, but here it's easy because there are only two companies, right? And third one has hardly any telecom in it. So it all stock specific call almost becomes sector call. But again, I would stay with the clear story here, with the market leader. Because there's no, you know, event risk either over there. And both are equally compelling, I would say, more or less. While it is true that this quarter, last quarter, might not have been that great, but I think just like in 2007, historical or current earnings had no relevance in terms of forward-looking. Current earnings have no relevance in forward-looking. I think returns of these companies are mid-single digit right now, returns on capital. Within the next 3 years, my sense is they would go up to over 20%. So you will see a significant increase in margins, EBITDA margins, significant decline in capital intensity. When there is spectrum auction next time, you'll have three players on the table rather than a dozen or half a dozen, right? So significant decline in capital intensity. So increase in EBITDA margins, decline in capital intensity, combination, perfect recipe for significant and accelerated ramp up in return on capital.
Okay, that's a underdog call. I mean, let me come to a call which is not quite underdog, which is anything to do with consumption in India. Sure. Some stocks are very expensive, but if your point is correct that growth picks up from here on, maybe in 2 years they don't look expensive, which pockets do you buy in consumption?
Certainly. You have to be there very selective. So I already gave a underdog and a not so underdog private financials as to example, but here also in consumer, I think you have to be very, very selective. Some of the durables, like appliance makers. You know, again, everyone and their brother is now making fans. Everyone and their brother is making LED lights and irons and all. So while demand growth is going to be there, competition is going to heat up in that segment as well. On the other hand, selectively, I think in discretionary consumption spend, let's say travel and tourism related.
Okay.
It's not a massive sector in India.
Yeah,
bunch of stocks. There are a handful of stocks. But I think there are some gem of opportunities over there, which are not like the individual companies over there are the sectors themselves. There are only one or two listed companies in that space, just like in telecoms. There are only a couple of companies really listed. So, you know, there are companies in travel, tourism, entertainment related.
You're talking about the, I mean, you won't name companies, but the vacation companies or the tourism companies like Thomas Cook or Cox & Kings, or are you talking about the hotel companies?
So beyond both of these categories, let's say wherever you go, you need to pack your bags.
Oh, okay.
Right? Then
luggage.
As one example, you know, entertainment, entertainment destinations. There are some opportunities in these unique pockets, which are fairly, you know, protected in terms of competition. The barriers to entry are very high. How many new players have you seen come in over the last 5 to 10 years in terms of brands in luggage making, right, compared to durables? Because the dynamics are very different. You need a different level of scale to break even compared to when you manufacture fan or lights.
Got it. Let me ask you about CapEx. I mean, your call is that in the next couple of years, we see a significant bump up in earnings. At what point do the industrials get in, where we see a pronounced capex recovery, and you can play some of these construction, infrastructure kind of names?
So I think the banking recap would help some of these sectors more so than government sector banks. Is what it would do is help these banks move forward with the cleanup. And that purging or cleaning is required for new credit cycle to begin. I think the credit cycle is best handled by private sector banks, but we just don't have enough of those, and hence you do need government-owned banks. And hence you would see these credit growth pick up in the industrial sector, and that should benefit the capital goods and capital equipment. I think could take 12 to 24 months.
You ready to take a bottoming out call in telecom? Can you take a bottoming out call on IT as well? Or not yet?
IT, not as strongly, I would say. I think, again, it is a very selective approach in IT, because, again, in telecom, there are just two players, as we discussed. IT, there's a very broad spectrum. I am not, negative from a sector perspective, nor I am, very upbeat to say that multiples are so low and hence the opportunity is very big. But I think selectively there are opportunities.
What's the biggest risk of a, which can trigger off a correction in this market now, a significant one? Because we've got fairly complacent over the last 1 year. No correction has lasted more than 3-4%.
Absolutely, since December 25th.
We ask people, they say, it's par for the course. Every time we get a dip, we'll buy it because that's the trade which works.
Certainly.
What can shake this complacency in your eyes?
Certainly. So Indian market, if we talk about specifically, one is, I mean, you can break the market price into two components, earnings times the multiple. So earnings growth, I see less risk, much lower risk. Mm. The risks to be concerned about or look out for would be multiples compression risk. Multiples compression risk could be due to domestic factors or global factors. Let's first take global factors. Anything that causes a sharp reversal in global markets and compression in global multiples would cause a pullback in Indian market as well, because the multiples around the world are linked. Now, what can cause a range of factors? Can any geopolitical event around the world can cause that? I think any spike in inflation, if there is, there's no sign of inflation exactly spiking. But if it does happen, then the bond yields in US, which is the ultimate benchmark or ultimate discount rate for all assets, would go up. Mm. And so if you think of the reverse of bond yield, which is trading at 35 to 40 times now, at 2.5 to 3% long-dated bonds, if that spikes, the multiple on bond, if you will, would come down. That might prompt multiple on equities to come down globally. So there is some, global event risk or inflation risk, I would say, to watch out for. The former is more in headlines now, though inflation, there's nothing around that suggests any inflationary pressure. In fact, if you believe in all this automation and robotics and artificial intelligence, it's all very deflationary longer term. There is no sign of wage pressure, no sign of input cost inflation, right? And that's what bond markets around the world are reflecting more than what is generally believed to be QE. Causing lower interest rates, right? So in these two, I would say, while low likelihood, still remain the risks from global multiples perspective. Domestically, I think the key risk, if you will, again, a very low likelihood risk, is risk of a coalition government at the center. If that were to happen, that would be a significant, in the immediate term or the near term, could be a risk to multiples.
In 2019, not
yes,
quite there.
Yes, yes, not quite there. If there is a weak coalition, I would say. If there is a strong coalition, that would be fine. But if there is a weak coalition, that could dampen the spirits just because of the experience of the last weak coalition government that we had.
Prashant, a pleasure talking to you today. Thank you very much for your time.
My pleasure, Udyan. Thanks for having me here.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.